Okay, let's get started. Hello, everyone. I'm Robert Winter, and welcome to another lesson with Music in the Air. MITA is a desktop application where you can learn about music in interactive ways you never imagined. We're going to use it today for our exploration of musical shapes and sizes. You can subscribe quickly and easily to MITA at our website, getmita.com. Okay, so what do these four selections all have in common? May have already guessed. Even though they are all from different centuries and from different countries, they're all dance music. Now, why would we pick dance music as a way of introducing ourselves to musical shapes and sizes? Well, for one thing, it's all very appealing, but there's another more fundamental reason. They all share two features that make them great entry points for perceiving musical shapes. They're repetitive and they're regular. That doesn't mean they all sound the same, as you've already heard, far from it. But we can use these two features, repetition and regularity, to build initial confidence in our own hearing, or even to just confirm what you already hear. You might also ask yourself, why is dance music built on regularity and repetition? Well, think about the dancing you may have already done in your life. If there's a musical surprise every 5 or 10 seconds, there's no way one person, much less two, could react quickly enough. Who would take to the dance floor for that? So, with these preliminaries out of the way, here we go. Now, we don't know a ton about medieval secular music for the simple reason that it wasn't notated for a very long time. The earliest notation was devoted to church music. So here we have, middle of the 13th century, a couple of Moorish singers playing what seemed to be early versions of a lute, at least one of them singing. So they did have secular music, it just didn't get written down much. So this particular first example we're going to look at, this estampie as it's called, is really quite special. Estampies are melodies that scholars have found that have no text associated with them, no words. They never show up with words. And that suggests, of course, that they were meant for instrumental playing. And from the character of these pieces that we're about to listen to, they suggest dancing. No one said, you know, in the parentheses in the manuscript, dance to this. But it almost certainly was dance music. Now, section one, section two, section three, four, five, six, seven. Wow, that's a pretty big number. How long does this number last? My God, almost 5 minutes. They must have written some really good tunes in those days. Well, every single one of these sections is based on a single melody that lasts about, here in this case, 10 seconds, 9 seconds, 8 seconds. Well, how then did the enormously talented group under Thomas Binkley at Indiana University put together this piece that would last a whole 5 minutes? Well, what they did is they played, as you can see here, when it says the A theme, A, 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 A. That means they played it over and over. And you might say, oh, that sounds like a lot of fun. Well, of course, what they did is each time they played it, they did something different to it. It's like you have eggs Benedict one morning, poached eggs the next morning, scrambled eggs the next morning, egg omelet the next morning, but they're all eggs. Okay, so the very first thing, by the way, I'm going to play for you is going to totally blow out the notion of regularity, but I found this such a delight when I first ran across this. This is played on the lute. You're going to hear 8 beats and then 9 beats. Now, if you know about 8, think about 8. It's 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. We're binary beings, right? So dancing, in fact, 99.99% of rock and roll, all the popular music is in what we call duple meter, groups of two or four. And by the way, these tunes have been collected, put together from various manuscripts. So the level of creativity needed by medieval performers is really almost they have to be composers and performers, as it will. So here we go. One, 8, 9. I think you probably heard that extra beat tossed in there. That was either sadistic on the part of the person who wrote the tune, or it was a dance that we don't know much about today. But what happens then here at this point? So what you heard this time, the second time, was it exactly the same as the first time? I'm going to start the first one again. Now this. So you heard that that was, shall we say, the same but different. But it was still essentially the same tune. So they're just embellishing it. Medieval and Renaissance performers all know that embellishment was a central part of the style because most stuff wasn't written down. And you are on your own. So, add a guitar. And now, embellish it. And now, even more instruments. And finally, repeats exactly. So you can see that our performers took 10 seconds of music and got a full minute out of it just by repeating it in a, we would say, embellished form. Okay, so that's our A tune. Now let's look at B for a moment. And you may have already noticed that each of these tunes, in fact, is two tunes. One is played in the first four or five seconds, and then it starts the same as it did the first time, but it makes a full, what we call, close or cadence at the end of it. So listen to this one again. Now again. Now, a fiddle gets added. Now let's toss a lute in. And finally, a guitar as well. Now I suspect everybody here, if you closed your eyes and looked toward the heavens, you could tell the difference between this tune and this one. I'm going to operate on the assumption that everybody can, but now we're going to go to another tune. Okay, what about this one? The lute plays first. Ah, you're thinking, I don't know if I can tell that one from this one. This one, and then... Okay, let's assume you can tell the difference. And then, now played in. A parallel thirds. And then the fiddle comes in. And now with an instrument called the lira or the lyra playing drones. The drone is holding the same note. Okay, so far you've heard three tunes. Can you tell them all apart? If I play this one, do you know that's the second section? Look away if you can. Is that the first one or the third one? Well, here's the first one. So you'll see, it's just like anything in life. Once you get beyond two or three, it gets a little bit more challenging. Let's go to the next page in section four. This one is so simple we could all sing it. Yum, bum, 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 bum. That's it. Yum, bum, bum, sing along. Bum, 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 bum. Okay, now the lute enters. By the way, those are little bells that were a common medieval or Renaissance instrument. So they're just embellishing that descent, right? And now with the fiddle and the lyre. Now the lyre plays parallel fifths. This will sound kind of cool. Okay, now the fifth one, we're only going to hear twice. Now you'll notice so far that these first six sections, right? Here's the sixth section. And this one is also interesting, by the way. We either hear 8 plus 10 or 8 plus 2 plus 8. What's interesting is you'll notice that up to this point, just the letters of the alphabet. Six sections, six letters of the alphabet. But look at the seventh one. They decided they wanted to make it a little more interesting at the end. So they're going to play a new seventh idea. That's this one, the steam and the lute. And they're going to put it in the middle, more or less. But they're going to get tricky and bring back this one. Does anyone remember what this one sounded like? Remember, that was the scale. The ya-da-da-dum, dee-da-da-dum. So here it is. Here it is again. Sort of like. And you'll notice what the human brain is particularly good at doing is hearing similarities and differences at the same time. That's what makes music so pleasurable. Now, we're gonna jump ahead now to one of my favorite Bruegel the Elder paintings. Okay, how many couples are making out? I'll give you about 5 seconds to figure that out. All right, the answer is 1, 2, 3. How many couples are dancing? Well, the same three. 1, 2, 3. The question is, where's the band? Do any of you see a musician? And possibly more than one musician. Here is a bagpipe player. And bagpipes are a very, very common means for playing dance music. First of all, you are a portable orchestra, a portable band. And second of all, most important, you are loud. So you could overcome all the din and noise inside the tavern. So this peasant danced. What exactly are they dancing? Some kind of dance that people seem to know the steps. At all events, let's jump right into one of my favorite dance types. It's called the branle, bubbled up. It was a folk dance that eventually found its way to court. And you'll notice here, this has not just got one idea, as we saw in the estampie we were looking at a moment ago, but there are two ideas. So the first idea is this. And then it repeats in varied form, and here's the B section. So you'll notice here, A prime, B, B, A, B. So it ends with the B, which gave a more incisive cadence or close, right? It's an ending. You've still only got 20 seconds of music. And you've made 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 seconds of music out of it. So repetition then has always been at the heart of dance music. Let's look at one more type here called a basse dance. Basse dance is a much more, shall we say, muted, genteel, quiet, more perhaps indoor kind of dance number. And here it is, the very dignified La Magdalena. That's just the name of this particular basse dance. Now you'll notice there are four different ideas or themes in this particular one. Here's the second one. Finally, the fourth one. Okay, so what we may have noticed right away is that C and D are faster than A and B. That really helps a lot. So this is more laid back, and this is more animated, right? And yet this is going to end more conclusively. In early music, the cadences are often, to our ears, quite abrupt. Okay, now we're finished. Let's go on to something else. And that's exactly what happens here. So we're seeing that these dances are getting a little more complex, a little more interrelated, a little more subtle as we go along. Okay, now we're going to move to one of my favorite characters in all of literature. This is Monsieur Jourdain of the Bourgeois Gentleman, Le Bourgeois Gentilhomme, by the great French playwright Molière. This dude wanted to become a member of the aristocracy, and in order to do that, you had to be able to dance, and especially the minuet. But here he is with his fencing sword, right? So he wants to look like he's really an aristocrat, if you ask him, but of course he never quite gets there. But there's a wonderful number in this play. This is incidental music that a composer named Jean-Baptiste Lully, a French composer, wrote for a whole series of Molière plays before Lully later turned himself to writing a bunch of operas. And there's a lot of music, like an hour and a half of music in this play. A Turkish sultan is coming to the court, and Monsieur Jourdain thinks that he's going to be crowned a special member of the Turkish aristocracy, when in fact, his daughter and her boyfriend have rigged this up so that they can get married over the protest of their father. Okay, I won't go into any further than that. It goes about 20 layers deeper in the actual play. But listen to what you've got here. Again, notice how a lot of these ideas, they're 10 seconds long. Now you'll notice the nomenclature now says halves. Instead of A and B, it says first half, second half. That's because in the mid-late 17th century and into the 19th century, a shape called binary form. Binary form simply means it's got two parts. Now, the thing about halves, remember when there was one piece of pie left and your brother wanted it and you wanted it also, and so one of you got to cut the piece and the other got to choose which piece they wanted? Well, this is kind of like that too, because the second half, as you'll notice, is 20 seconds long, whereas the first half's only 10 seconds long. So the musicians of the time, from that time on, have always referred to them as halves. So just getting the idea that all halves are not created equal. We have a first half and a second half. So here's the second half. Now, what's cool here is that this is 13 bars long. That's really weird. I'm going to take us right to the score for this, which we can do easily in MITA, and we'll listen to it. Here is, and notice, by the way, the French wrote everything in five parts. Five parts. They're kind of essentially what we would call two viola parts. These are not ever doubling each other, copying each other. They're always different. It's an amazing skill. It's a wonderful skill. So here's the first half, and then you can see this little device here with the dots in front of it means we're going to go back and repeat this over again. So let's hear it. Three, four, five, six bars long. Now, why aren't they eight or four like the other things that we listen to? Because they're French. And I say that only half facetiously. The French were always stubbornly independent. in everything they did. So six bar, first A section. Now you'll notice that it's getting a little bit louder each time it plays. What Jordi Savall, the wonderful leader of this ensemble that plays this, is, we imagine that the band, the Turkish Janissary band, is back somewhere, you know, 100 yards away or so. By the time they get to us, they're quite terrifying. And the Janissary bands were credited with having this ferocious, strong meter. Dump, bump, ya-da-dum, bump, ba-da-dum, bump, bum. And that's what gave them their great ability, actually, in many cases, to get people who were defending the town they were about to attack to surrender without a fight. Okay, so it's played a second time, and then here's the second half. Let's count how many bars this goes. Thirteen bars. So you'll notice now it's going to get, the second time here, even fiercer. We're going to add the tambourine. And by the way, again, there's no tambourine part. There's no person who trained and learned this part. There's simply a player says, ah, give me the tambourine, I'll play it. So here we go. Okay, then it repeats. And then we have the second half. And then the third time, they are right on us. Here we go. Soprano recorders are added. Okay, now I want you to quickly look away. I'm going to play either the first time, or the second time, or the third time, and you're going to tell me which one I was doing. If you want to look, that's, you know, that's fine. Okay, which time am I playing? The first time, second time, or the third time? And I know it. You got that. That was the second time, right? Here's the first time. We move backwards. It's all relative, isn't it? This is kind of loud. But relative to this, so if we were to recite this shape quickly, we would simply say AAB, sort of loud, AAB louder, and AAB really loud. And we've got the shape, we've nailed it. And we've noted the really kind of kinky phrase lengths, 6 and 13, that's kind of interesting. Okay, so we've got all the way up to the 17th century. We're now gonna go to good old England. You may already know about the River Thames that begins in the Cotswold Hills, nearly 200 miles west-northwest of London, and flows across the south of England through London before emptying into a tidal basin into the North Sea on England's southeastern coast. So London, too, like many great urban centers, was founded along a river. But the Thames has one really cool feature that no other urban river has. It's the push and pull of the tides that extends 75 miles up the river from the eastern tidal basin. About twice a day, it rises and then recedes. In Handel's time, it could move an unpowered barge at about 5 miles an hour for 20 miles or so. And if you timed it right, it gave you a free ride back. This is exactly what King George did in 1715. Listen to this account. About 8 in the evening, the king repaired to his barge. Next to the king's barge was that of the musicians, about 50 in number, who played on all kinds of instruments, to wit trumpets, horns, oboes, bassoons, flutes, violins, and basses. The music had been composed specially by the famous Handel, His Majesty's principal court composer. His Majesty approved of it so greatly that he caused it to be repeated 3 times in all, although each performance lasted an hour. The evening was all that could be desired for the festivity. The number of barges and above all of boats filled with people desirous of hearing was beyond counting. Indeed, the king did not return home until 4:30 a.m. I think that's probably well past most of our curfews. All right, so we're just going to listen to two of these wonderful dances from the water music by Handel. This may be the easiest shape you ever hear. I want you to look at these sections. How long does the first section last? 4 seconds. How long does the second section last? Oh, 8-9 seconds. And then it repeats. So it's going to be played first by the strings and trumpets, by the winds, the horns, oboes, and bassoons, and then everybody's going to jam on it the third time. This, by the way, was again a way of extending something that only lasted about 25 seconds, getting it to last a whole minute or a little bit more. So here's the first section. Listen carefully because it's going to be gone quickly. And that's going to be followed by what? I think we all heard that. Now the second half, which again is going to be twice as long as we've seen before, but it's also going to conclude or end in a more emphatic fashion. And then it repeats. And then we play it with the winds. And then second half. And then everyone. And the second half. Okay, now look away from the screen if you wish and see if you can tell whether it's the first playing of it with the strings and trumpets, the second with the woodwinds, or the third with everybody. Okay, are you ready? Here we go. Okay, and if you guessed it was the woodwinds, you are right. Did you know if it was the first part, the first half, or the second half? Well, here's the first half. Of course, what an infectious and memorable kind of melody. We're going to do a whole MITA session in the next couple of months on memorability. Why do we remember certain kinds of music, pieces of music, passages of music, and not others? But at all events, I think you would agree, this is quite memorable. And a bourré was a rapid dance in duple meter. Again, seems to have had folk origins, but bubbled up and finally made it to King George I's court. Let's look at one more kind of dance in Handel's water music. This is the minuet, which is probably the most intricate and difficult court dance ever devised. Take the 17th century court of Louis XIV, for example. Louis modestly judged himself to be the best dancer in all of France. His forte was the minuet, and if you wanted to gain access to his power circle, you learned the minuet. Can you think of any other king who would have showed this much leg in an official portrait? There are actually several different styles of minuet, and Handel provides two of them in his suite. The first one is slow, almost languorous, and with a lengthy upbeat. You can imagine dancers moving gracefully and carefully choreographed steps. You see the rest here at the beginning, and lentement, slowly. Let's hear just a little bit more of it. The second one is, by comparison, much more assertive and brisk, and suggests very different kinds of steps. And even though Handel does not label either one a minuet, every listener at the time, including good old King George, would have recognized both as minuets.
Mm-hmm.
Handel repeats it three times. Actually, Trevor Pinnock repeats it three times in a different orchestration. First, the trumpets and strings. Now we'll hear the woodwinds. And finally, this binary form, first half repeated, second half repeated. Everybody lets loose here. Let's just see a bit of that in the score. So even if you don't read music and I mute the volume, you can follow. So basically, each bar, that is the material in between those vertical bar lines, takes up the same amount of time. Now, not precisely, because being musical is knowing just when to push and pull ever so slightly. That's the difference between a kid who's been taking piano lessons for a year and a real artist. And think about this for a moment. What makes your life really tick? When do you feel like your life is really working? That's why many of us were baffled by a quarantine initially, because it was like, what day is it anyway? Every day seems to be the same. I can't go anywhere or do anything. That doesn't work for people. So what people have gradually done during this quarantine period is figured out ways to inject variety anyway into the sameness of their day. Change their diet, change their exercise pattern, do Zoom meetings with friends, things of that nature. We humans are naturally attuned to wanting not just the same thing over and over again. On the other hand, we don't want a surprise every day. Perpetual surprise actually is quite unpleasant, even if most of them might be rewarding. We like a balance between the two. And that's exactly what music is designed especially to do, to bring ourselves into a kind of equilibrium with ourselves. So the very act of listening then produces the kind of equilibrium that makes our lives work. Okay, friends, it's time for our friend Johann Strauss. You know this dude? Nice mustache, huh? I always wonder, you know, I mean, this is maybe kind of silly of me, but how did they kiss? Anyway, it's probably a silly question. Anyway, Johann Strauss Jr. is a fascinating story. I won't give the full backstory. His father had a band. He grew up with his father. His father then dumped his mother, dumped Johann Strauss Jr.'s mother and married a younger woman. Johann Strauss Jr. didn't like that very much, so he set up his own band and put his father out of business, in short. He went on to become the single greatest dance composer of the 19th century, and this is, in fact, the beginning of popular music. And you might say, well, it's been around a long time, hasn't it? Well, yes, it was in the music we've been listening to. But this is the beginning of the popular music industry. Look at this particular waltz. What's it called? The Eisenbahnlustwalzer, the railroad lust waltz. You had waltzes for everything. And notice this railroad engine, steam engine, is polluting heavily into the air and carrying soft bituminous coal that will also pollute Europe further. But again, there wasn't much of a green movement at that time. I love this picture. Who is the dandy here? Johannes Brahms in his kind of doctor-like overcoat? He's older, of course. Or the lithe young Johann Strauss Jr. with his fancy shoes and slacks? These guys were friends. They admired each other's music enormously. This new style of dancing that came in the beginning of the 19th century, the very end of the 18th, 19th century, looked like this. This is a watercolor that an artist did of what was called touch dancing. Now you might say, well, didn't all dancing involve at least, no, the minuet, the basse dance, all of these dances did not involve touching. That was thought perhaps to be too provocative and too distracting for people. So your hands might be like this when you were dancing, but you didn't hold them, you didn't clasp them. Well, look here at these various poses. We don't know how many of these were waltzes, but you can see that they're apart here, but then they come together. And look at this. my goodness gracious, this is enough to make your parents age 10 years in an hour. I found these two pictures of waltzing. This is an English couple waltzing. Now, why do English people waltz like this? Are English people a little bit dour and overly serious? I mean, my God, you'd think they were going to a wake or something. But here's how the French do it. Ah, yes. So, and of course, this would really express unforgettably the worst fears of parents. So waltzing then, this new style of dancing, it was thought to be the most horrible, dreadful thing in the world. It was the thing that was going to bring about complete ruin to every child. And of course, every kid was looking for every nightclub, every place they could go where they would have a chance to waltz. Okay, so we're going to go to one of the great Strauss waltzes called Voices of Spring. And you'll notice, if you look here, the first thing you look at is how many different sections are there? Oh, there's only A, B, C, D, E, F, only six sections. Well, we've already had something with seven sections, so this can't be that difficult. And it's organized this way. Notice how familiar this looks, in fact, to the dances that we were looking at from 400 or 500 years ago. Because, in fact, dances were almost invariably in sections that repeated. And so the curtain, and every waltz had a curtain, because that's when the couples bowed or curtsied to each other and got ready to then dance. And by the way, perhaps before we hear that, I just want to take a moment and point out that Strauss became pretty popular. This is a lithograph, a contemporary picture of a Strauss costume ball in Paris during the 1860s. Now you'll notice they sold tickets up here for people to come watch this thing. And here's Strauss with his baton way up in the air, his band behind him. And of course, these people are going kind of nuts. Now, one of the things that you may have noticed if you ever did a lot of vigorous dancing, either waltzing or anything else, is that if you spin around a lot, and this, by the way, is something practiced by Sufi religion, if you spin yourself around a lot, the blood goes, it's kind of weird, in your brain, kind of out of your brain, and you become, shall we say, lightheaded. This was exactly what parents were terrified of, because they thought, aha, the moment my daughter goes lightheaded, she won't be able to fend off that kiss that's now all too easy, because he's holding her in the first place. This was the kind of pandemonium that Strauss caused. And Strauss took part in festivals. Here's one in America. This is on Boston Commons, by the way. And there is an orchestra of about 10,000 people and a choir of about 20,000. I'm not exaggerating. On the Boston Common. And these are created for patriotic observances and big festival days. But what's interesting is that everybody sings or plays something. You have almost no audience, as it were. The audience is everybody there. And these are quite spectacular. At the end of the 19th century, 1899 this is, there is Johann Strauss Jr. at the top of the world. And who is then sitting at his feet? Here we've got Bruckner, Verdi, Brahms, Offenbach, I think. Who's this grumpy guy over here? That's obviously Beethoven. At all events, the Waltz King. Okay, so back to the action. The curtain, as it were. And that oom-pa-pa, oom-pa-pa, we call a vamp, V-A-M-P. Could go on as long as you needed to. And finally, here's the A section. Have you noticed there's a shape to that, a very romantic shape? It goes like this. Da-da-dee-da, 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 da-da-dum, da-dum, 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 da-dum. It rises sharply and then falls gently back to earth. We haven't heard tunes do that before. So once again. And then the B section. It's slower, it's a bit more rhythmic. Now, these waltzes were called Kettenwalzer, or chain waltzes. Literally, these are links in a chain. And these links were often reinforced by what are called a bridge. All a bridge is, there are three of them here, is a short bit of connective tissue between this section and this section. So here's how the bridge works. Okay, how about the bridge to the C section? Tender is the right word for this, yes? And the waltzers on the dance floor, by the way, would know this waltz already by heart many times over. And for each section, then, they would have appropriate steps that mirrored what the music was in fact doing. In the D section. And you may not have noticed what's called Wiener Takt, or the Viennese time. And what that basically means is the second beat comes a little bit early, and the third beat comes a little bit late. So you get um-bop-bop-um-bop-bop-um-bop-bop-um-bop-bop. It's very subtle and very slight, but it's exactly what gives the Viennese waltz its incredible flair. Okay, and a bridge then to the E section. And our last theme. And notice it kind of gets its start slowly and then runs down the hill. Now, of all these sections, which one appeared most frequently? The A section begins it and basically ends it with a little coda or tail tacked onto the end. And then it also comes back once in between. That's very typical of these waltz chains. So we got six of these. I'm going to play all six of them for you, the openings of them. And then we're going to have a little quiz, a little internal quiz, a no risk, no harm, no foul quiz. And C. D. E. F. Now, if you haven't figured this out already, MITA is great with couples. That could be a married couple or just two friends, because one of you can play this stuff and the other person has to guess what it is. And you don't do this to kind of trip each other up, but to help each other. It's a really easy thing to do if you've got a friend or a spouse to do it with you. And it's a fast, fast way. And by the way, you know, there's a whole philosophy these days of physical exercise and physical training, which says that very short, intensive bouts. Like, for example, I could walk into the kitchen now and do 90 jumping jacks, for example. That'll get my heart rate really going well. But then I'm not going to do anything for several hours. And then I might drop to the floor and do 10 push-ups. But I'm not going to do anything after that either. I'm going to do them very intensely, very as fast as I can, as full good form. Well, learning to listen and to hear works the same way. Get a friend, get down in front of MITA, and go five really intensive minutes, A, B, C, D, E, F, and go after it. And in those 5 or 6 minutes, you'll learn a ton. And then after 6 minutes, you'll be exhausted. You can't hear anything. All music sounds exactly the same. I could play the Star Spangled Banner, and you wouldn't know the difference. Then stop. And the brain will, when you sleep, get a whole lot smarter than you were before. Okay. This guy, of course, is well known to many of us. John Philip Sousa. He's this bearded guy right here. Sitting next to him is the great Arthur Pryor, the trombonist, who was one of the most amazing talents of the late 19th, early 20th century. Here is Sousa's band. Many of you will already know this particular piece. And notice, only three ideas. Sousa was smart. He wasn't going to make it too difficult. Here's A. And by the way, you may say, wait a minute, that's not dance music. Yes, it is. Actually, Sousa wrote many of his marches as dance pieces.
If you're skeptical about Sousa marches ever being dance material, take a look at these dancers, and they're doing the two-step to the celebrated Washington Post march. In terms of difficulty, the two-step was more or less the opposite of the minuet. But nonetheless, everybody danced to Sousa marches.
And then the C strain, what we call the money strain. This is the tune you walk away humming. And that's why Sousa plays it three times. There's a break, that is, the trombones come in and create this huge sense of anticipation. And then you all know this is this famous piccolo part. Same tune. Another break. And finally, sing along. July 4th is almost upon us. Here we go. You might be interested to see, by the way, the kind of score that these marches had. This is not a complete score. It's only got three staves, right? One bass clef and two treble clefs. But all the instruments are on here, and this was called a bandmaster's score. He didn't need a whole full elaborate score. He often didn't have the particular complement of trumpets or cornets or saxophones or whatever. He said, you play this, you play this. So here's the curtain, in other words. So let's go to that piccolo strain and see how that is with piccolo solo right here. So the piccolo part then is this little notes up here. It's written up here so the bandmaster could see, and the piccolo player did have a part actually. Now, what gives our minds such great satisfaction? Oh, we got this cool tune. Ya-dee-da-da-dee-da-da-dum. It's going so smoothly underneath, flowing like butter, melted butter. And on top is this peppy little piccolo part jumping up and down all over the place. That's so cool that those two live together. It makes our minds feel good. And then when everybody lets loose finally at the end, we got what? Now, guess where these marches came from, and guess what they spawned? Well, marches came from the French Revolution, actually, the modern marches that we know. But this man, of course, many of you know his name, certainly Scott Joplin, born in Sedalia, Missouri, and he grew to be one of the most important transitional and linking composers because he really ties together the art music tradition and the tradition that became jazz after the First World War. But if you go to a Joplin rag, which I'm going to show you right here, and we'll look at the score because it's pretty straightforward. Notice A, B, A, C, D. That looks very familiar. It is the same exact kind of structure of a Strauss chain waltz, but especially here of a Sousa march, because notice, for marches, you want absolute symmetry. 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16. You want that regularity all the way through. There's no curtain here. Sometimes a Joplin rag has a curtain, but we go right into it. So here we go. Okay, and then the A section repeats, right? And then we have the B section. Right now. And notice, could you march to this music? Absolutely, it is march music with syncopations. And Sousa himself got caught up in the whole ragtime craze. So that was much more emphatic than the A section, wasn't it? And then A section, A strain. And by the way, these were often called strains by march ensembles and by jazz players eventually as well. So here's the C strain. And notice where I've got yellow ovals here, how the bass line is so important, how it descends. So we had a melodious section, an emphatic section, the B strain. We had a more melodious C strain here. What will the D strain be like? Well, we can guess. Here we go. And the second time, of course, I played it a bit more energetically. And the harmony you're about to hear comes straight out of the playbook of Franz Schubert. Thinking, Franz Schubert? Isn't he dead? Didn't he live over in Europe somewhere? The answer, of course, is yes. But the music that Joplin learned when he was a youngster included, almost certainly, music of Schubert, because it has this wonderful kind of cadence, which you can hear. Nice. So you can see then the close relationship and the shape of a ragtime and of a march. They come from the same place, essentially.
Now, a final quick word about sizes. None of the pieces we sampled today exceeds 5 minutes in length, regardless of how they were expanded and embellished by their performers. What might be the reasons for that? Well, think first of all about the physical stamina of the average person. 4 or 5 minutes on the dance floor, and most of us are ready to sit down. But more important, think of the social constraints. The idea of dance cards, for example, was to ensure that no male could dominate a female's evening. 10 minutes could both wear a couple out and wear out the gentleman's welcome. Finally, I also want to underscore that what we've done today just gives a novice a very good introduction to musical shape. But if you're closer to the expert level, then the level 2 commentary and the listening guides, plus all of the commentaries and the interactive scores, gives you a ton more for your ears and mind to chew on. Unlike a book, MITA can take you all the way from kindergarten to a postdoctoral seminar. Okay, that's a wrap for this week. I really hope you enjoyed our little 9-stop tour of musical sizes and shapes, and we'll have another interesting angle for next week when we talk about the West and the musical frame. I hope you'll be able to join us. So long.